Hello everyone, my name is Prashant and today I'm going to discuss about debugging IO issue. So the aim of this presentation is to show the various open source tools available and how can we use those tools, and with the help of those tools, how can we narrow down the issue. So the main idea of this is, like, because the disk is slowest among all the components which we have available in our system. So let's say we have a different component like CPU and memory, and disk is probably the slowest among all those components, and that is the reason which is causing the performance bottleneck. So in this presentation, I'm going to show you the various tools. So let's get started. So the first tool I'm going to show you is the ps command. I think everybody is aware of this command. So many of them, you have used this command ps primarily for use for CPU and memory stats, to show the CPU and memory stat. But it also doesn't give you a stats about the disk IO. While it doesn't tell you info about the disk IO, it does show the process state, which can be used to indicate whether or not the process is waiting for IO. So let's say if you run this man ps, and if you go to this process state, you will see that the process have a different state. In this presentation, we are mainly focused on the two state. One is the uninterruptible sleep, and second one is the running or runnable or run queue. The reason for that, for focus or emphasizing on these two, because the load average of in your Linux system is the sum of two things. One is the running state of a process, and second was the uninterruptible state. So running, I think already all of you are aware of the running state of a process, that the process which is in a running state, which is currently running. The uninterruptible or D state of a process is a special state where any process, while waiting for read or write, the process will put in a special kind of a sleep known as a D state or the disk sleep. The reason these processes are called special, because we cannot kill these kind of a process with the help of a signal, like for example when we run the kill -9 command to kill any of the process, that is called a sick kill. So we cannot issue those kind of a command to these state process, because signal can only be delivered to a process in a run queue, and these processes are still lies on the IO queue. More about what are the different means, what are these IO queue, is like in the upcoming presentation or in the next series of this presentation. So the question is, how can you see, like, if your process is running in a D state or it's in a runnable state? So I think runnable state, you can easily find it out. For D state, with the help of ps command, you can easily find it out with the help of psauxw. And since this is a mostly an ideal system, so you cannot see a D state process, but in your system which is having a D state process, you can easily find it out with the help of this command. Okay. So here, if you can see, if your process is running, means if any of your process goes to a D state, you can easily find out with the help of this D command. And then you can run simply W command to see, like, the load average of your system, which will be showing the format of 1 minute, 5 minute, and 15 minutes. Okay. The second command is, which I'm going to demonstrate, is a vmstat command. So vmstat 1 and 3. So with the help of vmstat command, you can also see that any of your process is in the D state or not. So the second column of the vmstat, which is the B, which will count you the number of processes which are in the D state. So the first command, the ps-aux, will give you the process name, while this will count you the number of processes which are in the D state. But for the performance point of view, or from the IO point of view, the important column which we need to monitor is the bi and bi, which is the number of blocks in as a number of blocks out. So to see how these works, let's see vmstat, and in another one, run this td command, and output it into any file. Let me box that equal to 1k or equal to 100. So here you can see the impact of DD, that you see some number of blocks which are going in and number of blocks which are going out. number of blocks which are going in and the number of blocks which are going out, same way here. Okay, so this is how. Also remember, please always ignore the first row which has been represented by this VM stack. And the reason I am telling you that you can ignore this, because this contain the average value since the last time the computer was rebooted. Okay, so always ignore this. The other command which you can use to see this IO is the top command. So I think everybody use top to debug any, to see the what are the processes which are consuming the highest CPU, or what are the processes which are consuming the highest memory utilization, or the process which is using the highest amount of memory. By default, it's sorted out with the help of with the process which is consuming the highest CPU. If you run shift with M, you can sort it out with the help of the process consumption based on memory. Okay, but the column of interest from the IO point of view is called percentage weight. So if this percentage weight is high, you will see the number, you will see the CPU is waiting for your IO access. So that will be a bottleneck. Or if you look at the main page, the percentage weight is the amount of time the CPU has been waiting for IO to be complete. Okay. Now let's look at the very important tool, which is called SAR. So it's come from the sysstat package, which consists of other tool, which is like really, really important. So let's see. So it is having IO stat, which we are going to discuss after this top, or after this SAR. MP stat, PID stat, these are all important tools. So SAR is having a really important tool. It must be installed in your system to debug any of the performance issue. It will tell you about the CPU utilization, memory utilization, IO, network utilization even. So if the, in this presentation, since the IO weight is the point of interest for us, so let's run SAR with hyphen U option and 1 and 3. And here you can see the IO weight. Okay. So whatever the tool I have discussed so far has one limitation. Like it tell us like exactly, okay, yeah, we have a IO issue, but it will not tell us like which of the disk is contributing for that this bottleneck. So for that purpose, we have a tool called IO stat, which if you run without any options, it will just give you some basic stats. But the real power of IO stat is when you run it with the option tkx-p 1 and 3, and with rel 6, you need to add this hyphen p to see the per partition. Hyphen t is for timestamp, k is for kilobyte, x is to show you the extended output. Okay, so like this. So this, it will give you the output like this. Now let's cut short it. And yes. So now I'm not going to discuss about each and every column. I'm just going to discuss about the important column from the performance point of perspective. In the upcoming presentation, I'm going to discuss about each and every column. So the important column is the read request merge per second and the write request merge per second. Okay, so to demonstrate this, I'm just going to show you with the help of small ASCII art. So generally, apps sends a request to your block layer, which ultimately sends the request to your IO scheduler layer. Which will send it to the driver and ultimately to the storage. Okay, so this is where your request merging will take place, and it will depend upon the type of scheduler you are going to use. So by default, the CFQ is the default scheduler, but depending upon whatever the application you are using, you can choose a scheduler, or whatever the scheduler you have choose during your testing of that application, you can choose this. So for, let's say if you are using a database, then the deadline is a default scheduler, or deadline is a suitable scheduler. But if you are using any virtual machine or any storage device, then the noob or no operation is the scheduler of choice. So to see different kind of a scheduler used by your system, you can see here sys log sda, depending upon whatever the device you are using, queue and scheduler. So the default one is CFQ. If you want to change it, you can change it with the help of this one. Now if you can see, this comes out to be the noop or no operation. If you want to revert it back to the CFQ, you can change it. Since this system has only the one default hard disk, which is the dev SDA, if you want to change it for the per hard disk or for per like for example, if you have a dev SDB, you can do it. For example, for dev SDA, I want the CFQ as a default scheduler, but for other hard disk, I want to use like let's say deadline as a scheduler, so I can also do it. So I just need to pass like this and whatever be the hard disk or the disk I'm going to use it. If you want like for each and everything, you want like deadline as a default scheduler, the way you can do it is like boot grub.conf, and here at the this line you can use elevator is equal to whatever, for example deadline. So now the important column is average queue size, okay, which defines the average number of requests within this IO scheduler layer, okay, and within the IO scheduler queue plus the average number of IO sending to the storage gun, okay. So at each and every at these two layer, your request will be queued, which will depend upon this parameter nr underscore request, okay. And at this layer it's called queue depth, okay. Just remember, this driver is just a thin layer, it is not going to hold any of your requests. The function of a driver is just to repackage it in an acceptable form to the your host bus adapter or to your network interface card, and ultimately after repackaging is just going to send out that request to your storage. So as long as the request remains below, as long as your this NR request remains below this queue depth, the IO will flow smoothly from here to here. The problems start arising when the number of pass IO passed to the driver exceeds the LAN queue depth. So if this will increasing and your storage device or your hard disk is not compatible enough or not smart enough or not fast enough to process those requests, then you see all sort of issue, like your percentage utilization shoots up, your average queue size increases, and you will see all kind of your process going to a D state, all those issues, okay. So still I can say that IOSTAT is really really handy tool to means earlier investigation tool you can use to debug any sort of a IO issue. Now even IOSTAT has one limitation, okay. Earlier we find it out, okay, this is our IO issue, we find out like this disk is creating the bottleneck for us, but still we don't know which is the process which is responsible for creating those disk bottleneck. So for that we have one tool called IOTOP, and with the help of IOTOP we can even see what is the process which is contributing for the access of disk read as well as disk write, okay. But for IOTOP to work, it has a two basic requirement. The basic requirement is for per process IO monitoring, it should have this file log self IO. So let's say I have this process proc 1 which is having a PID in it, which is having a PID 1, and it is creating this much number of read requests and this much, and this output is in byte. So KB MB, 55 MB of data it is reading, and similarly 21 MB of data it is, or actually yeah, 21 MB of data it is writing, okay. And one more thing, this has been introduced in RHEL 5.8, okay. So and the other thing is you need to have this parameter compiled along with your kernel. और अनेबल इंडिया करना कॉल्ड आईओ ऑन दिस पर्सन इनकमिंग अकाउंटिंग इट शुड बी सेट टू यस ओके सो दिस इज अ काइंड ऑफ अ इशू दैट इफ माई सिस्टम लेट्स से आई एम रनिंग दिस आईओ टॉप इन रेल 5.7 और सेंटोस 5.7 I must need to recompile my kernel to make it work. So in that case, you should, there is one tool called System Tab, which is a really, really popular tool. It is like a, for example, in Solaris, we have a dtrace. So similarly in Linux, we have System Tab, which is a framework which allows us for easy probing and instrumentation of any component inside kernel. For any component, for that probing purpose, it uses kprobe. And for any component means it should be anything. Means system tab can be helpful to debug any CPU issue, IO issue, network issue, or any of the memory issue. Means it's a really, really handy tool. Okay, so to run this, you need to have stab-v. Okay. So it will give you some means somewhat similar stats, not much stats like this is given by IOTOP, but it will at least tell you which is the process which is contributing to your disk IO. Like let it run. Okay, so here like the system is not doing much of a stuff, but if it is doing, it will tell you like this is the process which is doing a read or this is the process which is doing a write. So to demonstrate that, I can again run my dd command. Okay, so dd if is equal to dev 0 output is equal to mnt abc2 block size equal to 1k count equal to 100. So here if you can see, yep, it was able to capture this dd command. Then this is a dd command which is doing the read and the write. Okay, now thus means the biggest tool among the all, which is called a BLK trace. And if you want to see each and every IO which is going to your system and you want a, like a detailed analysis of each and everything, the BLK trace is a tool for you. With the help of a BLK trace or a block trace, we can investigate IO pattern at the block level. I can say you can debug each and every performance issue related to IO with the help of the BLK trace. The only issue with the BLK trace is that it will give you a lot and lot of output, and means you need to be really patient, and you need to be like really, it will a time consuming tool, or it will take a lot of time and effort to grab or to learn this tool. So I'm just going to show you something basic. I'm going to demonstrate it much in my upcoming videos. So for this, you need to have this debugfs file system to be mounted. Kernel and debug. Okay, this is already mounted, and I think some of you are aware of that debugfs is used to bring out the kernel space event into a user space. Okay, now run the BLK trace. Okay, and once you run the BLK trace, it will create one file at the end. You need to rerun Control C to end your operation. This is called SDA, your device name, block trace, and the number of CPU, which is 0. Okay. And to parse this output, you need to have some tool called BLK parse. And then you can give this file name. Okay. So these are some of the bits which the source of interest. And some of the common ones are like this one. I can show you here, yeah, which is like IO handled by request queue code, or like I show you with the help of this diagram. So means where I show you the diagram here. Somewhere we have missed it. So the this is primarily work on this block layer. You can see how the IO is inserted into your IO scheduler. Okay, IO inserted into your request queue, IO issued to the driver, IO completed, request plugged, unplugged, everything you can see with the help of this BLK trace. Okay, so this is just a little bit introduction how you can debug the performance issue related to the IO. In the upcoming video, I am going to elaborate all these tools. So thanks for watching this video. Thanks once again.